The death toll from two landslides in southern Ethiopia jumps to 229. A government official says that number could rise further as the search for survivors and casualties continues into a second day. Following heavy rains, a landslide buried people in the Gofa zone Sunday night. A second one engulfed others who had gathered to help Monday morning. Ethiopia's prime minister says he is deeply saddened by the terrible loss of life and that federal officials had been deployed to reduce the impact of the disaster. Let's get an update on the weather now from PAGASA forecaster Robert Madrina. Robert, good morning.
Good morning. So here's the latest on our weather, particularly on Typhoon Carina that we're currently monitoring. So as of 4 a.m., the center of the eye of Typhoon Carina was estimated at 290 kilometers northeast of Itbayat, Batanes. So this typhoon has a maximum sustained winds of 155 kilometers per hour near the center and a gustiness of up to 190 kilometers per hour. Its present movement is northwestward at 25 kilometers per hour, and because of Typhoon Carina, tropical second wind signal number 2 is hoisted in Batanes, while signal number 1 is raised in Babuyan Islands, northern portion of mainland Cagayan, as well as northern portion of Ilocos Norte. So these areas with the tropical second wind signal may experience gusty winds, rains with gusty winds, as well as potential impacts on threat to life and property. But the rest of the country, particularly in Luzon, may continue to experience moderate to heavy up to intense rains. Sometimes there also we also monitor torrential rains in most parts of, particularly in western section of Luzon, that's Ilocos region, central Luzon, Calabarzon, including Metro Manila. So this is the effect of the enhanced southwest monsoon because of Typhoon Carina. So for today, we will continue to experience continuous rain with an intensity of moderate to heavy up to intense and sometimes torrential rains. As of 5 a.m., we already raised the red heavy rainfall warning in Metro Manila, Rizal, and Bataan, while orange warning in Bulacan, Pampanga, Cavite, Zambales, and yellow warning in Tarlac, Laguna, Batangas, and Quezon. So these areas may experience a flooding, particularly in flood-prone areas. We are also reminding our especially those who are living near the mountains of the possibility of landslides, and also those areas that are flood prone may experience flash floods. So we hope that everyone is safe, especially with this two weather systems, the typhoon and the southwest monsoon. We're expecting that the Typhoon Carina may make a landfall within the day in northern part of Taiwan and may exceed the Philippine Air responsibility by tonight or tomorrow morning latest. So that's the latest on our weather from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. I'm Robert Padrina.
Thank you so much, Robert Padrina, reporting live from PAGASA. Bad weather battering parts of the Philippines. The country's disaster management agency verifying 8 reported deaths due to the combined effects of the southwest monsoon enhanced by Typhoon Carina and tropical cyclone Puchoy. All of the fatalities were from Mindanao. The storms have already affected nearly 180,000 families, displacing about 7,000 of them. Meanwhile, initial damage to agriculture is pegged at 80.7 million pesos. While damage to infrastructure was estimated at 700,000 pesos. Flooding also hit several parts of the Philippines due to torrential rains. Some roads are impassable in Metro Manila due to gutter and knee-deep floods. At least 49 families have evacuated in Mariveles, Bataan, following a landslide. Meanwhile, in Pampanga, water levels have reached 4 feet, with residents already using boats to move around.
Tuloy-tuloy po yung pag-ulan kagabi, and of course yung bumababang tubig galing sa upper stream natin, ine-expect na natin na papunta na dito, plus yung high tide. So yan po, compounding effect.
But in Tuguegarao City, farmers consider the rain a blessing.
Malaki ang tulong ng ulan kapag yung ang niya ay tubig ng niya ay mahina, hindi agad makarating.
The bad weather also forcing class and government work suspensions. Malacañang has suspended government work and classes at all levels in Metro Manila upon the recommendation of the country's Disaster Management Agency. Aside from Metro Manila, here's a look at other areas which canceled classes today, July 24. In other news, two Philippine legislators call for a law that would institutionalize a presidential ban on offshore gaming operators. The country's gaming regulator has started to implement the president's order to close all POGOs by the end of this year. Victoria Tulad reports.
Effective today, all POGOs are banned.
It's the end of the line for Philippine offshore gaming operators after President Marcos ordered their closure. And attention now shifts to the Philippine Amusement and Gaming Corporation, or PAGCOR, on how to wind up POGO operations by the end of the year. PAGCOR vows to comply with the directive, which would mean losing a huge chunk of government revenues, not to mention the workers who will be displaced in the sector.
Na PAGCOR po, 7.5 billion. Pagkatapos doon, meron pong BIR na dapat po nakakakulikta ng 2.5 times sa PAGCOR. Bilang utos ng Pangulo, gagawa natin ang paraan na yung kanyang timeline na katapusan ng taon ay maipatupad natin.
According to PAGCOR, around 40,000 Filipino workers will be affected. But even before the president's order, concerned government agencies like the Department of Labor and Employment and Department of Social Welfare and Development have begun studying ways to cushion the impact of closing the industry.
Aasahan po nila na kami po ay magkakaroon ng ugnayan sa kanila. Mayroon pong mga intervention kagaya po ng pagkakaloob ng tulong on a temporary employment program. Meron din pong livelihood, meron pong training, upskilling.
For the Philippines' chief economist, eliminating POGOs will have a negligible impact to the overall economy. NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan argued this sector had little contribution to the country's GDP in 2022.
More important than just the economic numbers, no? I think the social cost and reputational cost to the country of hosting this kind of businesses is not good at all. I think that the president would like to see legitimate businesses, businesses that give good reputation to our country as investment destination, as tourist destination, not ones that encourage criminality.
But how about the so-called IGLs, or Internet Gaming Licensees? PAGCOR says they are covered by the ban. Assistant Vice President Catalino Alano Jr. explains, IGLs are different from e-games or electronic gaming, which includes PIGO, or Philippine Inland Gaming Operators, sports betting, online casino, e-bingo, and specialty games. IGLs are offshore games, which means bets are made outside the country, while e-games are domestic games. Another concern raised by stakeholders, including the Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission, is the possibility of POGOs or another iteration getting a new lease on life once the Marcos administration ends. Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, who has been one of the most vocal POGO critic, sees the need for a law. House Speaker Martin Romualdez agrees.
Let's not play around with terminologies. They can rebrand it, they can come up with different names, but it's actually defined under law. The committee is contemplating to pass a law so that any form, any iteration of this POGOs will not be allowed under this administration and also with the succeeding administration.
But for Senate President Francis Escudero, it's as simple as revoking the licenses issued by PAGCOR. Or according to Escudero, just ban all forms of gambling.
Hindi EO ang nag-legalize sa POGO. Hindi AO ang nag-legalize sa POGO. Hindi batas ang nag-legalize sa POGO. Lisensya na inisyo ng PAGCOR ang nag-legalize dyan. Kaya ang pag-ban dyan, pagbawi lamang ng lisensyang binigay ng PAGCOR ang kinakailangan. Sa galing ng mga tao sa larangan yan, mag-iimbento palagi yan. Pago, pugo, pego, sa dulo, kung nais natin pagbawal ang pasugalan at sugal sa bansa, pues pagbawal na natin lahat. At susuporta ako palagi doon. Mapapogo, mapapigo, mapakasino, e de sabay-sabay na natin kung talagang tingin natin nakakasama yan sa ating lipunan at sa ating mga kababayan.
The Office of the Solicitor General, however, disagrees, saying an executive order is needed.
That was a policy statement, and I suppose that the appropriate administrative issuance will be made by the Office of the President in order to implement this policy statement made by the President yesterday.
Meantime, both the Senate and the lower house say they will continue their investigation on POGOs to identify the people behind them. PAGCOR now says it is banking on land-based casinos and earnings from special BPOs to cover any lost revenues. Victoria Tulad, ABS-CBN News.
The governor of the Philippine province of Cavite denies his family is protecting an offshore gaming hub in a resort they once owned. This exclusive report from Zian Ambrosio.
When President Bongbong Marcos Jr. announced POGO operations are no longer welcome in the country, questions were raised over one of the biggest POGO hubs south of Metro Manila, known as the POGO Island. This sprawling complex is located in Kawit, Cavite, in what is used to be the Island Cove Resort owned by the Remulla family. To clear up any questions about the island, Cavite Governor John Vic Remulla spoke exclusively with ABS-CBN News. First off, Remulla says they no longer own the 11-hectare property.
Binili ng tatay ko yan 1970. When my father died 2014, slowly yung assets ng pamilya namin, dinidispose namin para hindi kami mag-away magkakapatid.
Sir, how much did you sell it?
Well, safe to say we paid mga 400 million in taxes.
Who owns it na pala, sir?
A group of Phil Chinese, a consortium of Phil Chinese people.
Is it correct, sir? Kim Won is the owner?
I think it's better that you ask him.
Attention shifted to the Pogo Island following recent raids by Philippine authorities on illegal Pogo operations in Tarlac and Pampanga. The Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission had said Pogo hubs are being used as a front to engage in illegal activities. Governor Remulla says he is aware of the comments on social media, including questions on why the property has yet to be inspected. The governor rejected allegations that the local government is exerting influence or protecting Pogo operations in the area.
Hindi kami protector niya na. The Remulla family has no holdings, no interest, no business dealings with the owners, the new owners of that company.
Remulla insists they have no hand, much less any involvement in the approval of the Pogo Hub, despite members of their family occupying government positions. Two of his brothers are working in the government, with his brother Jesus Crispin Remulla seating as Secretary of Justice, and another brother connected with PAGCOR. Remulla also reiterated his challenge that he will give 10 million pesos to anybody who can prove that his family is connected with the Pogo Island in Cavite.
For any information that can be proven na tumulong kami para magka-Pogo license yan, na protector kami ng establishment na yan, na tinutulungan na kinubinigyan namin ng permit para mag-occupy yan, na ginagamit namin ng kagawaran ng hustisya. Kasama na rin yung kapatid ko na director sa PAGCOR. In no way or form kaming may signature or may efforts para ma-promote or protect yung Pogo na yan.
The governor also says he will coordinate with the mayor of Kawit, Cavite to ensure compliance with the president's order.
We will make sure na wala nang operations ang business operations sa lugar na yan. I will also issue an executive order to the mayor of Kawit to respect the president's decision and to inspect the premises pagdating ng December 31.
The Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission assured the public government's POGO crackdown applies to all.
Hindi sacred cow yan na para hindi natin galawin. Malapit na.
The commission adds they are cooperating with local government units to identify and close POGO hubs in their area of responsibility. Zian Ambrosio, ABS-CBN News.
U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris hits the campaign trail for her first rally since replacing U.S. President Joe Biden as the Democratic presidential candidate. Speaking before a crowd in Wisconsin, Harris assailed Trump, promising compassion over chaos. Wisconsin is a battleground state in the November 5 election.
So Wisconsin, before I was elected vice president, before I was elected United States Senator, I was elected Attorney General of the state of California, and I was a courtroom prosecutor before then. And in those roles, I took on perpetrators of all kinds. Predators who abused women, fraudsters who ripped off consumers, cheaters who broke the rules for their own gain. So hear me when I say, I know Donald Trump's type. And in this campaign, I promise you, I will proudly put my record against his any day of the week.
Meanwhile, a new Reuters poll showed Harris holding a slight lead over Republican nominee Donald Trump. 44% of the respondents said they will vote for Harris, while 42% backed Trump's White House bid. While Harris continues to consolidate the Democratic Party's support for her White House bid, the top two U.S. Democratic congressional leaders endorsing Harris as the party's nominee. This after the most dramatic party delegates committed to back and Harris the at the party's roll Vice call President vote Harris in early August.
Vice President Harris will soon be our nominee and will be elected president in November. We are brimming with excitement, enthusiasm, unity. Since President Biden's announcement, we've seen the Democratic Party swiftly coalesce behind Vice President Kamala Harris. When I spoke with her Sunday, she said she wanted the opportunity to win the nomination on her own and to do so from the grassroots up, not top down.
President Joe Biden has made the selfless decision to pass the torch to Vice President Kamala Harris, who is ready, willing, and able to lead us into the future. Kamala Harris and her candidacy has excited and energized the House Democratic Caucus, the Democratic Party, and the nation.
U.S. President Joe Biden heads back to Washington 2 days after ending his reelection bid. Biden spent nearly a week recovering from COVID at his home in Delaware as he weighed his 2024 candidacy. He ultimately dropped his campaign and endorsed Vice President Kamala Harris for the Democratic nomination. Biden will speak to Americans from the Oval Office Wednesday night about his decision not to seek another term in office. U.S. Secret Service Director Kimberly Cheadle has reportedly resigned following the agency's failure to stop an assassination attempt against former President Donald Trump. The Secret Service faces a crisis after a gunman was able to fire on Trump from a roof during a campaign rally in Pennsylvania earlier this month. Cheadle faced bipartisan condemnation when she appeared before the House of Representatives Oversight Committee on Monday, declining to answer questions from lawmakers about the security plan for the rally. Several Republican and Democratic lawmakers called on her to resign. Cheadle took the responsibility for a shooting, calling it the largest failure by the Secret Service since then-President Ronald Reagan was shot in 1981. I am keeping him and his family.